seminar obviously of the season, so thank you for coming. A couple of things before we start. Has everybody signed the register? Most people, if you haven't, on your way out, or if you didn't sign the register, so you know obviously who's been here, haven't, the numbers, etc. If you did want a certificate, obviously make sure that the box is ticked, just obviously give you them a CPD certificate at the end, and they'll all be laid out on the table in the back, so when you leave, just pick them up obviously on your way out. And there are a few feedback forms just dotted around. If you do want one, I have got some more copies. Feedback's always welcome, not just obviously on the presenters, the evening, but also any ideas that you guys want to see for presentations in the future. So we actually use these when we set up these seminars. So for next year, for example, if there's something that keeps recurring in the feedback forms, then obviously that's something that we most likely then be putting on for you. So obviously we want to make sure that we've got current and obviously interesting subjects that you guys want to actually hear. Okay? So thank you for coming. I'll introduce our speaker for this evening, Richard Hayes from Fortitude Partners, and he's here to talk to us about maintenance factors. So without further ado, I'll pass you over to Richard.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. Everybody hear me at the back? Right, maintenance factor. I suppose I'd better introduce myself. Richard Hayes. I've been in the lighting industry for about 35 years now. Started off as a laboratory manager with a local lighting company not too far from here. Eventually became technical manager for that company, involved in luminaire design, optical design, running the lighting design office as well as the laboratory and testing end of it. 25 years ago, my business partner and myself got fed up with the slippery corporate slope and set up our own company, 42 Partners. We were the first independent test laboratory for photometry set up in the UK. We had a very nice 22-year run, and we sold it off to somebody else about 3 years ago. Our main competition at the time was BSI, and it took us 22 years to get BSI out of business, but we finally managed to close down their photometric laboratory. So my background very much is in testing and the technology of lighting, if you like. Here tonight to talk about maintenance factor. We all know, I suppose, when we're doing lighting design, that we need a maintenance factor. But why do we need a maintenance factor? Where does it come from? And really, how is it relevant to the modern sources that we're using, particularly that elephant in the room, which is LEDs? We all know these days that most of the stuff we ever run across is LED-based. Is the methodology that we've got for assessing the maintenance factor in the light of LEDs any good? Can we adapt it to use it in the light of data that we've got for LEDs? Is the data that we get for LEDs from manufacturers suitable for the purpose of assessing a reasonable maintenance factor? I think these are valid questions that need to be asked, and I think as lighting designers we might conclude that we need to push manufacturers to supply us with more and better data so that we can come up with a decent maintenance factor. The need for maintenance factor really comes from CN12464 Part 1, 2011, which says in Clause 4.3 that the average illuminance for the task shall not fall below the value given in Clause 5, regardless of the age and condition of the installation. So we flick through EN12464, we come to Chapter 5, we look at what we're doing in office lighting, we look it up, it's in Clause 5.26, which is office lighting. 5.26.1, I think, is general tasks within an office, and it says that we need 300 lux. What that means is we need 300 lux at the end of the maintenance cycle, and if we apply a maintenance factor, on day one we will have more light, and it will gradually degrade over time until we've got 300 lux. The lowest acceptable illuminance level that we can have to that specification is therefore 300 lux. It goes on a bit further in 12464 when it says in clause 410, the recommended illuminance for each task is given as maintained illuminance. So it makes it quite clear that those numbers are the maintained illuminance figure, not the initial illuminance, but the maintained illuminance at the end of the maintenance cycle. It says also that the lighting scheme should be designed with the overall MF for the selected lamps, luminaires, surface reflectances, environment, and the specified maintenance schedule. And it says the designer shall state the MF and list all assumptions made in the derivation of the value. And it also says that the designer shall prepare a comprehensive maintenance schedule to include the frequency of lamp replacement, luminaire, room, and glazing cleaning intervals, and the cleaning method. So it's the responsibility of the designer to specify all of those factors that go up to making the maintenance factor, and to tell the operator of the space afterwards how the space shall be maintained to make sure that that maintenance factor calculation is appropriate ongoing in that installation. It says further on in 12464 that guidance on the calculation of maintenance factor is given in a document called CIE 97, 2005. Maintenance factor is defined in CIE 97 as the ratio of the average illuminance on the working plane after a certain period of use of a lighting installation to the initial average illuminance obtained under the same conditions for the installation, therefore taking into account all of the losses, including lamp lumen maintenance. And it puts a nice little formula there that says E maintained equals E initial times the maintenance factor. And that's the definition of maintenance factor. From the terms of a lighting manufacturer, it's a tax on lighting. Because if you've got a maintenance factor of 0.8, you've got to put 20% more fittings in and install 20% more power to make sure that your maintained illuminance is what you need it to be. It talks about things like non-recoverable factors, NRFs. And it says these are due to the irrecoverable degradation of the surfaces of the room that can't be recovered even by cleaning. It mentions cases like oil and dust particles burnt onto the reflector, so that even cleaning of the luminaire cannot return these factors to the initial condition. Now, the concept of non-recoverable factors is quite interesting when we come to LEDs. Because it's quite obvious in CIE 97, written in 2005, that its methodology is based on the fittings that were around at that time, the luminaire technology that was available in 2005. And these were things with fluorescent lamps in and HID lamps in. So that the lamp was a replaceable item. Now that's quite an important concept which we'll come back to. It lists as recoverable losses, and it makes a point about this, that these are supposed to be recoverable losses. Luminaire maintenance is recoverable. You clean the luminaire and it goes back to almost its initial level. The room surface maintenance, you clean the room and it goes back to near its initial conditions. The lamp lumen maintenance is recoverable because when you replace the lamp at the end, the lamp lumen maintenance is recovered and it goes in the lamp, goes back to its initial lumen output. And lamp survival. If the lamp fails, you replace it. So all of these are sort of applicable to LEDs, but nobody really knows how to apply them to LEDs, at least that's the experience that I've had so far. LEDs have thrown a bit of a curve into this whole process. This is a typical diagram that you'll see in CIE 97, and I've just sort of rejigged it to make it a bit more clear. We start off with relative illuminance on the left-hand side, vertical axis of the graph. And if we start off at 100% illuminance on day one when we switch everything on, the room's clean, the luminaires are new, the lamps are clean and new, the drivers are clean and new, everything's as it should be, we've got 100% output. Over the period of the maintenance cycle, CIE 97 expects us to have about 3% non-recoverable losses. So even if you, at the end of the maintenance cycle, clean everything, replace everything, it doesn't expect you to get back to 100%, it expects you to get back to around 97% of where you were to start with. You can see there that you've got various curves that add up to give you the overall maintenance factor. So the green curve there is the room surface maintenance curve, and it declines fairly slowly. You can get a different curve for different types of room, so we'll come on to this a little bit later. You've got the lamp lumen maintenance curve, which is a nice contentious figure that we'll come back to later. In the days of fluorescence and HID lamps, these were standardised curves that most of the big manufacturers, Philips, Thorn, GE, etc. produced. And they were all largely the same because they were all using the same technology. can see here on the luminaire maintenance curve, one of the main things that happens is the luminaire gets dirty. So the purple curve there is the luminaire maintenance curve. And what happens, of course, is that we clean the luminaire at intervals that we specify. So the luminaire maintenance curve drops, then we clean it, goes back up, drops again, we clean it again, and it drops until we get to the end point. So if we plotted the unmaintained output of adding all these four curves up, we would get down to here, and you can see in this example we'd have a maintenance factor of about 50% if we didn't clean the luminaire. What this graph shows that with two cleans and a third clean when we relamp, that the overall maintenance factor would be about 0.8. So cleaning the luminaire and the luminaire maintenance factor is an essential part of getting a decent maintenance factor for any installation that you've got. So specifying the luminaire cleaning interval is one of the most important things you can specify in your derivation of maintenance factor. It's quite obvious here that that would yield maintenance factor 0.7. If you didn't clean the luminaire, you'd have a maintenance factor 0.5. This is the whole point of cleaning luminaires and cleaning room surfaces. There's also a sort of inherent unspoken assumption in COAE 97 here. The graphs that are produced in COAE 97 just happen to go to about 15,000 hours. And 15,000 hours, back in the days when we had fluorescence and HRD lamps, was about the sort of economic life of the lamp. So there's a sort of built-in assumption to COAE 97 that the economic life of the lamp is linked into a reasonable maintenance period. So the whole methodology of COAE 97 leads us to say, you start off on day one, you let things degrade, you do a bit of cleaning, you let them degrade a bit more, you do a bit of cleaning, you let them degrade again, then you replace the lamp, clean the fitting, clean the room, and you get back to 97% of where you were on day one. Now, what we're told about LEDs is that they last forever and they never fail. So where do they fit into this sort of thing? The assumptions that were made in COAE 97 aren't directly applicable to LEDs. Or are they? We'll come back and talk about this a little bit later on. Just to sort of ram it home, I'm sure you've all seen this before, but I'm going to go through it anyway, just to bore you. The maintenance factor is defined by four sub-factors. The room surface maintenance factor takes account of the accumulation of dust and dirt on the surfaces of the room. And COAE 97 classifies the room in four categories, from very dirty through clean to normal to dirty. And it also says what type of activities are associated with those different room types. Now, I'm going to read this bit. Offices and schools and hospital wards are classified as clean. Shops, laboratories, restaurants, warehouses, assembly areas and workshops are classified as normal. The only things that are mentioned in COAE 97 that are very clean are things like silicon wafer plants, clean rooms and hospital clinical areas. So most things that we're going to come across in most of the sort of maintenance factors we're going to be doing in general lighting are either clean or normal environments, and that's quite important to bear in mind. The LMF, the luminaire maintenance factor, takes account of the effect of dust and dirt accumulation on the luminaire. Luminaires are classified against their degree of sealing and their type of distribution and the type of luminaire. So if you have a sealed IP65 luminaire in a clean environment, you would expect it to get dirty and degrade slower than an open-topped uplighter in a clean environment. So these factors are the type of luminaire. The luminaire maintenance factor will vary depending on the type of luminaire and the environment into which it's installed. LSF is a lamp survival factor. It takes account of the effect of failure of light sources during the maintenance period. Now, there were classically two ways to handle this. You could spot lamp replace, and when a lamp failed, you could replace it. Therefore, there's no effect on LSF, so you can write LSF in as 1.0. Or you can do a bulk lamp replacement, which was economically good with things like fluorescence, where you let a certain percentage of lamps fail, knowing that the overall illuminance level in the room is going to drop, and at the end of the maintenance cycle, when you go in and replace your lamps, you replace all the failed ones, clean the luminaire, and everything goes back to normal. So that's a factor that is fairly specific to things like failing lamps. And the lamp luminance maintenance factor takes account of the effect of lumen depreciation of the light source during the maintenance period. Now, I'm sure none of you have ever done this, but there are LED manufacturers around there who are going around telling users of LED luminaires that they can use a maintenance factor of 1, because the LEDs never fail and they don't depreciate in lumens. Both of which are incorrect, but even if they were true, that only takes out these two factors. The room is still going to get dirty and the luminaire is still going to get dirty. So any luminaire manufacturer who tells you you can use a maintenance factor of 1 because these luminaires are LEDs, the best thing to do is show him the door very quickly, because he's talking out of his fundamental orifice. But I have heard this mentioned quite a few times from LED manufacturers, particularly at the, should we say, the more cost-effective end of the market. Later on in the document, after it's published the formula at the top, CIE 97 drops in a little joker. And it says that actually, maintenance factor should be LLMF times LSF times LMF times RMF times NRF, non-recoverable factors. And it puts the asterisk in, and it says the asterisk means that if there are significant non-recoverable factors, these should be included in the final maintenance factor. So what it's saying is that if your non-recoverable factors go much above 3%, you've got to take them into account in your maintenance factor as well. So we'll come back to this as a concept when we're thinking about what LEDs do a little bit later on. When you work your way through CIE 97 and you look at it in various cross tables, and it can be a bit of a, I don't know whether anybody's ever done it, it's a very boring exercise, you come out in the end to a value. CIE 97 also gives you some typical values, and it's a sort of indication of what it's expecting your maintenance factor to be. This table is lifted directly from CIE 97. It's table 4.1, and it says it's a typical set of values for a medium-sized room with the various lamp and luminaire type combinations. Now, the first thing to notice about this is there's no mention of LEDs. So LEDs were not considered at all when we were doing CIE 97. And if you're looking at the environment there, you'll see it goes VC for very clean, clean, normal, and dirty. And it lists the various types of lamps, and it lists the various types of luminaires. Now, A to F, A to E generally goes up in ceiling in the luminaire. F and G are things like air handling luminaires and odd cases like that. So the sort of bulk of things in clean and normal conditions for most types of lamps and fittings, we ought to be sort of in this area. And CIE is sort of leading you towards your maintenance factor to make your installation economic should be in the region of, say, 0.7 to 0.8. Maybe a bit above, maybe 0.85 if you've got a really nice environment and a really well-sealed luminaire. But, of course, that's only true under the circumstances we've got here. And it's saying it's a medium-sized room, the cleaning interval for lamps and luminaires is 1 year, the cleaning interval for room surfaces is 6 years, failed lamps are spot replaced, and if you're doing bulk lamp replacement, you ought to do it on this sort of cycle. And it gives us typical LLMFs, lamp loss maintenance factor, lamp lumen maintenance factor. And it's looking at factors mostly, sort of, metal halide's a bit of a weird one, 0.9, 0.94, 0.95, that sort of area is where we should be looking for a usable LLMF. So it's leading us down this path. It says with regard to lamp lumen maintenance, for accurate data, always consult the manufacturer.
Now, when I was doing lighting design, I never managed to get a manufacturer to give me any meaningful plant bloom and maintenance data. But it would be nice if they did, wouldn't it? Now, we come really to the crux of the matter, which I suppose is LEDs. And I put there, when is a lamp not a lamp? Because I think that's quite a valid point. We can classify LED luminaires into two types. Luminaires that have a lamp, i.e. if you've got a retrofit type luminaire where you've got a BC or an ES type lamp in an old style fitting, you can plug an LED lamp into it. That lamp becomes replaceable. T5, T8 LED lamps are technically replaceable lamps. I'm not wonderfully convinced that they're a good idea, but they're out there. Lead corn bulbs to replace high pressure sodium lamps and metal halide in amenity lighting in floods would be a replaceable lamp. We're now coming into the stage where we've got fittings which are built around things called Zarga modules. Zarga modules are an agreed set of standards. Zarga is a consortium of LED manufacturers where everything is interchangeable. So you can take a 32 watt linear LED Zarga module from manufacturer A, driven by a Zarga module B, and at the end of its life you can replace it with a module from manufacturer D and a driver from manufacturer E. And because they're all built to the Zarga standard, they're all interchangeable. Now it might not still be very easy to do that, but at least it gives you the opportunity to claim that in some way the luminaire was maintainable at the end of its maintenance period. I still think that from my experience, the type 1 LED luminaire is relatively rare. Most of the LED luminaires we come across are monolithic, non-maintainable luminaires, where the LEDs are such an integral part of the construction of the luminaire that you cannot take them out and replace them at the end of their life. So if you can't take them out and replace them at the end of their life, when you calculate the maintenance factor for that particular type of fitting, and it gets to that point in the maintenance cycle, the only thing you can do is take the fitting out of the ceiling, escort it to the recycling plant, and drop it in. Because 12464 and CRE97 says you are not allowed to let the luminance level in that room drop below that maintained value. So therefore, you must replace it. Now that obviously has massive implications for the economic viability of LED luminaires. Massive implications. If we look at some typical values, and up until very recently I was the distributor for Relux in the UK, so I've taken this from Relux. I will say for the interests of bias that calculation algorithms like this are available in other lighting design programs. But most lighting design programs have something like this built in. This just happens to be the one from Relux. And it builds up a maintenance factor to CIE97. So I can build up two typical maintenance factors there. And assuming an LLMF of 0.95, we can see there that on the left I've got a normal environment. I've got a cleaning interval of 3 years. The luminaire is enclosed IP2X, a standard sort of module downlight that's not particularly sealed. And that would yield a maintenance factor of 0.62. If I shift the parameters a little bit and say I've got a clean environment and I've got an IP5X fitting, which is reasonably well sealed, which a lot of LED luminaires tend to be these days, then that maintenance factor can come up to a lovely value that we'd all expect on date. Now the first thing you can gather from this is that this is wonderfully fiddleable. And I have seen a lot of very reputable manufacturers claiming that their luminaires have an overall maintenance factor of 0.85. And yes, I can go through that table, and you can do it in Relux, and you can erect a final maintenance factor based on a lamp, an LLMF value of 0.95, you can get a maintenance factor of 0.85. But usually to do so, you've got to start knocking down the maintenance intervals. And I've seen a manufacturer, quite a large manufacturer, who states his luminaires have a maintenance factor of 0.85, and it quite clearly states, based on a 6-month cleaning interval for the room and the luminaire. Now, hands up all those who've ever seen an installation that's cleaned at 6 months intervals. Nobody. Right, thought as much. So, you've got to be careful about the claims that manufacturers are making for their maintenance factor. If you use a program like Relux, and I'm sure Dialux has something very similar, you can check their calculations to see how they derive their factors. This is going to come as a shock to you. Luminaire manufacturers don't always tell you the unvarnished truth. Shock horror, bro. We need to get some sort of feel as to where our LED luminaire is going to hit an LMF that's going to be useful to us, about 0.95. Now, the thing that you get most often is a table like this. Boom. And it says, reported TM21 lifetimes. Now, TM21 is a standard by IESNA, the Illuminating Engineering Society of North America, and it's called Projecting Long-Term Lumen Maintenance of LED Light Sources. And it takes the data that is generated from a test method, which is IESNA LM80. And LM80 is approved method measuring lumen maintenance of LED light sources. So the LED chip manufacturer takes some of his chips under very careful laboratory conditions, under very stable temperature conditions, with a non-practical driver, puts his chips under test. He measures the initial lumen output, and every 1,000 hours, through to about 6 or 10,000 hours, he measures the lumen output again, and he produces a set of data for TM21. He uses that data, to LM80, he uses that data in TM21 to fit those data points to a curve, and the method of fitting those data points to the curve is specified in TM21. And TM21 allows him to project the life and lumen depreciation of his LED out to 6 times his test data period. So if he's got 6,000 hours of data, he can only project a life out to 36,000 hours. And if he's got 10,000 hours of data, he can project it out to 60,000 hours. You can see here that we've got some typical figures. So, first line there, particular data set for a particular LED at a case temperature of 105 degrees C, a drive current of 1500 milliamps, has an L90 at 10,000 hours. Now those two figures, L90 10K, the L figure is the percentage of initial lumens that the LED achieves at that time period. So what that's saying is that L90 is out at 35,000 hours. At 35,000 hours, that particular fitting reaches 90% of its original output. It reaches 80% of its output to 60,500 hours, and it also, strangely, reaches 70% of its initial output to 60,000 hours. That's because he's not allowed, from 10,008 hours of data, to project more than 60,500 for his life. So he's limited by his data set, and he's limited by what TM21 will tell you. Now, if I wanted to use an LLMF of 0.9, 0.8 or 0.7, that data's wonderful. But that's not really any use to me, because we've already seen that I probably need an LLMF of about 0.95 to make my maintenance factor useful. So TM21 isn't giving me enough information. But that's usually all that you'll get. So you could take a guess. You can say, okay, 90% lumen output is reached at 35,000 hours. It'll come back somewhere and I can take a guess where it's going to reach 0.95. Or you could try and find some TM21 data curves. Now there's a typical TM21 data curve. Now that was one of the best ones I could find, and it took me a long time to find it. You have to delve into the dim depths and recesses of LED manufacturers' websites to find this sort of stuff. They don't make it easy for you. You also see that they've... Okay. They've made a mistake in the data, or cynically they've tried to hide a bit of something, that they've not even normalised the data back to 100% light output. They've normalised it to slightly above 100% light output, which sort of distorts things a bit. But you can see there, the points on the data set, the red graph, the blue graph, and the green graph, that the data stops at 10,000 hours, and they're projecting out to 60,000 hours, which they're allowed to do, and it's giving us the depreciation curve for these things. So, if we alter the curves down to a 1, and we sort of think about where we're going back, where would I get an LLMF of about 0.95? And I think the only thing I can come to the conclusion of, it's somewhere between 10,000 and 20,000 hours. So let me see. The manufacturer comes to me and he says his wonderful LED lasts 50,000 hours. But I can only use it in a lighting design to get a reasonable maintenance factor if I limit its life to somewhere between 10 and 20,000 hours. So the economic life of an LED, when you take into account TM21 data, is about the same as it was for an HID lamp and a fluorescent lamp. So the wonderful thing of an LED lasts for 50,000 hours, my first thing on that is, so what? It's of actually no practical use to you. Because if you're going to use it for 50,000 hours, you're going to be down here in LLMF. And when you plunge that into your maintenance factors are going to go south to 0.7, 0.6, 0.5. Now, are you going to commercially, economically, suggest a job with a maintenance factor of 0.5, 0.6? Nope, here's the simple answer. Would be probably commercial suicide. So, this whole edifice we have of LEDs that last 50,000 hours is practically no use to you in the economic case that you're in most of the time. Now, there are another set of standards, and mostly from the manufacturers, there are a couple of exceptions, but they are few and far between. You are given TM21 data to prove the LLMF and the life of the LED in the luminaire that they're trying to sell you. Now, there are another set of standards. There is a test methodology called IESNA LM84, which is the approved method for measuring luminous flux and colour maintenance of LED lamps, light engines, and, my bold at the end, luminaires. Well, notice I contrast this to LM80, which is light sources. So LM80 is testing chips, LM84 is testing luminaires. TM21 is the data extrapolation method from LM80 data for light sources. TM28 is the method of projecting long-term luminous flux maintenance of LED lamps and luminaires from LM84 data. Now, you might have noticed that I have a tendency towards cynicism. Who believes that if I take an LED under LM80 test conditions, stable laboratory conditions, stable driver, stable temperature, under nice laboratory conditions, and I declare its LLMF curve, and I take that same LED and put it in a luminaire with a practical driver, who believes it would have the same LLMF? Nobody. Good. Because I don't believe it either. But I have never seen a set of TM28 data presented by a manufacturer. I've asked manufacturers why not. And they do come up with what at first point seems to be quite a reasonable excuse. I'll use the term excuse. They say that the whole industry is moving at 3 billion miles an hour. So if you're talking about doing 6 to 10,000 hours of testing, 6,000 hours of testing is about 9 months. 10,000 hours of testing is about 14 months testing. So if luminaire manufacturer starts with a new LED luminaire, January the 1st, 2017, the earliest time he can get me some reasonable data is about September. And if I want long-term data, it's going to be February next year. By which time he'll have changed the driver and he'll have changed the generation of the LEDs in his luminaire twice, at least, because the industry's moving that fast. Now, that's an excuse because there are two things that he doesn't tell you. In TM28, there is a straight extrapolation from all LM84 measured data. But there is another methodology in TM28 which allows you to stop testing your fitting, well, not to stop testing, but to take your fitting data up to 3,000 hours, which is only about 4 months. Use that combined with TM21 data for the chip to get a combined extrapolation of the likely lumen depreciation of the luminaire over 20 to 30,000 hours. So the excuse that it takes too long really disappears out the window. They could supply you some data after 4 months of testing. The second one really is that as a lighting designer, if you gave me some TM28 data on a luminaire and said that was the luminaire we were making last year, and since then we've changed this chip with this set of TM21 data to this chip with this better set of TM21 data, I, as a grown-up lighting designer, can make a judgment call as to about how I affect that in my maintenance factor calculation. But if they don't give me the data and they don't treat me like a kid who doesn't know what he's doing, then I can't make any judgments. So I do think the manufacturers are not serving you in the best way they can in giving you a very limited set of data that isn't 100% applicable to the case that you need to be considering when you're calculating the maintenance factor for LED luminaires. Guarantees are interesting, aren't they? What does the guarantee cover? Nice LED luminaire salesman wanders into your office and tells you his luminaire's good for 50,000 hours. Yeah, it'll still work. It'll still glow, but will it glow enough to give you a decent maintenance factor? Or at 50,000 hours, will you have to use a maintenance factor of 0.5? In which case, it's absolutely no use to you. The luminaire may still be working at 50,000 hours, but at 20,000 hours, it's going to be replaced or relamped or re-leaded. But to get this into the parlance, re-leaded, I think is a... I've got a patent on that one, by the way. There's other stuff going on here as well, apart from the data that you need to calculate it. We've got to ask some serious questions about the way that CIE 97 assigns these LMF factors to luminaires. Are they relevant to LEDs? And there's some argument and discussion about this in the industry at the moment. So let's consider two sort of cases. Old style ones where we pretty much know that the CIE 97 luminaire maintenance factors are applicable would be 150 watt high pressure sodium flood. It emits into the space about 12,500 lumens at about 165 watts when you've taken into account the fact that it's got the ballast in there to drive it. The temperature of the front glass lap luminaire is likely to be in the region of 85 degrees C. The lamp surface temperature is going to be anywhere north of 250 degrees C. But we're going to replace that with a nice 100 watt LED flood, which gives out about 12,500 lumens at about 110 watts input. The front lens temp is likely to be down south of 55 degrees C. The actual emission surface temperature of the LED, if it's a good fitting, is probably going to be down to about 50 degrees C. So, in the same environment, which one of those is going to degrade faster due to Bacton contaminants? So the CIE 97 LMF factor for that type of luminaire, you would expect the LED luminaire to be better. So you can ease up on the maintenance factor a bit. And I would quite agree with anybody who is an LED salesman who told me that. But it can work the other way as well. If you take two typical fittings that you'll see, something like a 32 watt compact fluorescent lamp, twin fluorescent, open top reflector, stick it through a recessed ceiling, and we all know all the stuff that falls on the back of these fittings. It will probably have very little effect on the lumen output and life of the lamps in that compact fluorescent if you get an inch thick layer of dust on the back of that fitting. If you replace it with this type of fitting, where you poke it through and it's got a big heatsink on the top, and the maintenance of the LED is directly related to how well that heatsink dissipates heat. How well is it going to dissipate heat with an inch thick layer of dust on it? So in that case, the factor that you apply to that luminaire, the LED will be worse. So we've got a swings and roundabouts case. The interesting thing is that I don't know of anybody who's come up with a suggestion to change the LMF Datron CIE97. It obviously needs changing, but we don't know how and we don't know why. We can point to cases where we think it will be better for LEDs, and we can point to cases where we think it will be worse than LEDs. So what do? As designers, we've got a responsibility to our end client to try to come up with a reasonable assessment and maintenance factor. Remember that what CIE 97 says is that for accurate LMF data, ask the manufacturer. I'm sort of winding to a conclusion now. I think as designers, as lighting designers, we've got to be much tougher on manufacturers. We've got to ask manufacturers for LM84 TM28 data. Not just LM84 and TM28 data, I'd like to see the curves, so that I can actually assess LLMF at different points on that curve to see what effect it has. Just giving me a table that says L7050K isn't that useful to me. I really want to know what the junction temperature or the case temperature of the LEDs within that fitting is. Because from that TM21 curves I've shown you, the hotter the LED, the faster it degrades. Now, TM21 constrains manufacturers to test at two case temperatures, 55 degrees C and 85 degrees C, which ought to be fine for most cases. You'll see that on the one that I put up, there was a very fast degradation, 105 degrees C case temperature. So, knowing the case temperature or the junction temperature of the LED and the luminaire you're specifying will be vital to you assessing the decent maintenance factor for it. I think, sort of in conclusion, I'd say as lighting designers, we haven't pushed manufacturers hard enough. Manufacturers, like everybody else, they're trying to make a living out of selling light fittings to people. If they don't have to spend money, they won't. But if enough people ask them for it, then they'll start producing this data and everybody will be better off. That concludes tonight's demonstration. Thank you very much. But what CIE 97 says, if you dive into it, is that the maintenance factor should be erected to give you a good economic case. Now, economically, if you put in luminaires in a foundry, then you would expect the maintenance factor to be very low, below 0.5. And CIE 97 says that. So if you install lighting in a foundry, then you're looking for 500 lux on the working plane. On day one, you've got to expect to get 1,200, 1,300 lux. But it will drop off very rapidly. In most of the sort of normal commercial and industrial, CIE 97 is saying to us that it expects a maintenance factor in the region of 0.7 to 0.8. That's what that table 4.1 says. Now at that period, if you're aiming for 500 lux, you're only going to be getting 600, 650 on day one, and it will decline to 500. To me, that's fine. If you start erecting a maintenance factor in an office of 0.5, and you expect people to wander in on day one and work under 1,000 lux and let it degrade over 50,000 hours, which is going to be 10 years at 24 hours a day, to 500 lux, That's unacceptable. So, I don't think there's anything inherently wrong with the CRD97 approach if we take into account the things that it doesn't specifically say, but is sort of hinting strongly. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think it's a little bit of knowledge about the danger.
Yes. Yeah, there's just enough knowledge to be dangerous is a state that a lot of people are in.
Maintenance factors is something obviously I know you're a lot of people know about. Deal with, but when it comes to actually knowing the details of it, sometimes it just gets a bit lost, doesn't it? So it's good to have a bit more knowledge now. Hopefully, it's helped you guys and help with understanding actually what maintenance factors are and how we actually use them. So, any further questions? Okay, well, just want to thank Richard. Thank you. You've come a long way, obviously, to come and see us and come talk to us this evening. So, just finally, just like to say thank you very much. Thank you.